JRA501, I'm in nuclearcrimes.org, and I'm going to be reading from a side panel on 10 pages that I've been reading on the Nevada fallout and the effects of that and the cover-up that they ensued. So, there are people like Patrick Penry who are also trying to find out why we don't have current cancer studies. And one of the reasons is because, let's just say in the state of California, the data is collected. It takes a long time to collect that data from the medical industry. Once that's collected, it then has to be pooled into the history. And that data has to be, you know, pulled together. And so sometimes it takes like a couple of years for that to actually be published. So is there a way to actually figure out what the possibilities would be based on what the possibilities of cancer would be concerning nuclear fallout? And so let me just get into this. Bioaccumulation of iodine-131. It is crucial in any discussion about past fallout effects to examine accumulation of fallout toxins in human organs. A similar phenomenon occurs with the bioaccumulation of mercury or PCB toxins in animals at the top of the food chain. Weapon testing fallout fell on grass from coast to coast, was eaten by cows, then secreted in their milk and accumulated in the thyroid glands of milk-consuming children and adults. So, without revealing my age, when I was a kid, we drank milk almost with every meal. I never drank sodas, but we drank a lot of milk. Iodine-131 mimics naturally occurring iodine-127, a non-radioactive element that is sold in pharmacies for first aid uses. Both iodine-131, the radioactive version, and iodine-127, when ingested, pool in the thyroid gland. And this was known prior to 1951 when the testing started in Nevada. In the case of weapons testing fallout, the thyroid gland was a terminus in a food chain of filters in which water-soluble radioactive iodine-131 produced in nuclear explosions traveled through the air into the grass, which was eaten by cows, secreted through milk, fed to humans, and pooled in their thyroid, and at virtually every step in the chain, the concentrations of radioactivity increased. Each part of the chain further distilled certain radioactive fallout toxins so that humans, or the feeders at the top of the milk food chain, bore the greatest contamination burden. The question we ask here is how much more concentrated was iodine-131 in milk-drinking human thyroids compared with the levels present in America's air during atomic testing during the Cold War? To determine this bioaccumulative factor for iodine-131, we have to identify the attributes of the chain. The first part of the chain is the air-grass dynamic. Iodine-131, which is usually in the form of a gas heavier than air, easily settles on vegetation, or grass. During a fallout event, the grass keeps accumulating iodine-131 fallout on a per kilogram dry weight basis, becomes several hundred to thousand times more radioactive than the air above at ground level. A cow grazing the grass will accumulate the iodine-131 in their stomachs, and about 10% on a daily basis of the iodine-131 in the cow's body from pasture feeding will be passed on to its milk, which amounts to roughly 25 liters daily. The milk contains slightly amplified iodine-131 levels than the rest of the cow's body. Since a lactating cow's daily milk output in liters weighs about 25 kilograms, the cow's milk is about 5% of the cow's gross weight, if that cow weighed around 500 kilograms. On a weight basis, the iodine-131 that shows up in its milk is about 2 times more radioactive than found in other tissues or organs other than its thyroid. Further amplification of the iodine-131 continues when the iodine-131 is absorbed into the human body via milk consumption. There, the thyroid gland absorbs about 20% of the iodine-131 in the milk. That percentage is also called thyroid uptake. The iodine-131 is concentrated in the relatively small volume of the thyroid, which for an adult weighs only about 20 grams, but for a child weighs just 2 grams. On a per weight basis, the thyroid gland in adults weighs about 1/3,000th of the entire human body. Yet, 20% of the radioiodine pools in that gland. In the transfer chain of iodine-131 to milk, iodine-131's rate of loss of radioactivity, it decays by half in 8 days, but is still minutely radioactive even after 2 months. That played a role. In many areas during the Cold War, milk was consumed by Americans the very day or day after it was milked, and even shelf-bought milk was radioactive, although sometimes somewhat less. When all is said and done, as a very rough estimate, the dose to the thyroid from drinking iodine-131 contaminated cow's milk is about 1,000 times the dose from inhaling the same iodine-131 contaminated air that descended on the cow's pasture grass. Perhaps the best phraseology of the above statement can be found in a 1976 article titled Social and Environmental Costs of Energy Systems by 2 scientists working in Berkeley, California. They wrote that extensive studies of this chain have shown that if a human drinks milk 1 liter per day from a cow constantly grazing on grass exposed to iodine-131, your thyroid receives a dose about 1,000 times greater than the thyroid dose received by merely breathing the same air. The thyroid dose concentration level, in some cases, has been estimated higher to a factor of 2,000 or 3,000. This bioaccumulation factor, more or less, has been the accepted value in scientific literature over many decades, although it has been sometimes less. The above cycle of iodine-131 poisoning may continue if the cow milk consuming human adult passes the toxins through breastfeeding to their children. Iodine-131 was one of the most damaging toxins from the Nevada testing fallout, though certainly not the only severely damaging one. The superaccumulation of this radiological substance in the thyroid organ did a lot of damage. And in 1997, the National Cancer Institute predicted that between 10,000 and 75,000 people exposed in youth to widespread radioactive fallout of iodine-131 during the U.S. nuclear bomb tests might, during their lives, get radiation-linked thyroid cancer, and roughly 5 to 10% of which will be fatal. Idealists believe even those estimate ranges are too low. Iodine-131 is not found in nature. It can only be manufactured, dumped, or emitted into the environment by cyclotrons or nuclear fission processes and experiments. Strontium-90, which makes up about 3% of the fallout, also bioaccumulates in milk. Most of the strontium-90 that poisoned our food supplies came from huge hydrogen bomb testing in Russia and out in the Pacific. For more, read about the global fallout. Scientists fought for a ban on nuclear testing in 1958 and 1963 based on findings that levels of strontium-90, a beta emitter found in infant teeth across the globe, was rising and rising. This led notable public health experts to predict a coming health crisis if above-ground nuclear testing wasn't halted. Well, we know that they blew that off. The hazard posed by radiostrontium was known before the atomic bomb was even invented. Strontium-89 was injected in patients before 1945 to reduce pain from bone cancers. Cattle absorb 25-30% of the ingested strontium, with about 25% reaching the bone. A few days after entrance of radiostrontium into the body, about 99% of the remaining amount will be in the bones. Jenkins cited an UNSEER report in 1997 that stated, in general, it may be said that 90 strontium in the diet comes mainly from milk products, grain products, fruit, and vegetables. Milk products contributing about 30% of the strontium-90 transfer from food in the area's study. Iodine-131 and other radionuclides like strontium-90 is still being released by nuclear power plants, permitted by as low as reasonably achievable radiation standards, and by weapons production plants. Even hospitals release radioxenon and/or radioiodine into their community's air and their patients' bodies. Okay. So in Wikipedia, I'm moving ahead to today, continuing on with iodine-131, is also one of the most commonly used gamma-emitting radioactive industrial tracers. So as we all know, hydraulic fracturing is going on everywhere now. It's the new thing. And has been for years, but I think they've just upped it. Excuse me. Radioactive tracer isotopes are injected with hydraulic fracturing fluid to determine the injection profile and location of fractures created by hydraulic fracturing. Much smaller incidental doses of iodine-131 than those used in medical therapeutic procedures are thought to be the major cause of increased thyroid cancers after accidental nuclear contamination. These cancers happen from residual tissue radiation damage caused by the iodine-131 and usually appear years after exposure, long after the iodine-131 has decayed. So herein lies the problem, is that there's no way to hold anybody accountable because the cancer does not show up within weeks or months. It takes years. So I just find this to be very frustrating, especially in light of what is still going on with Fukushima. So I guess, and it's not just in cow's milk. It's going to be in your organic fruits and vegetables. I mean, nothing is even safe anymore. I guess that's why I got so frustrated in the last couple of days, that I just went all out and just ate whatever I wanted. You know, it's like, okay, I've already been exposed to massive amounts of everything under the sun from Fukushima fallout, the original fallout, almost 2 years ago, and it's still ongoing. But what are you going to do? Stay in the house? Not do anything? You know? So I'm just seizing the moment, living for today. And as always, God bless.